Hey, everybody. Welcome to another great episode of Roundtable with Steve. I'm here today with Andrew Gillum. This man is going to be the next governor of the great state of Florida. Right now, he's the mayor of Tallahassee. And from what I hear, he's doing a great job. All right. So we want to see him bring the same things that he's doing in Tallahassee to the state of Florida. Welcome, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much for having me. It's a real honor to be with you.
Tell me, what kind of platform are you running on? What is it that that our viewers need to know about what you're doing and what you intend to do with the state of Florida?
Well, one, I want them to know that South Florida is home for me. I was born and raised partially between an area called Richmond Heights, which mm-hmm. is in South Dade. Mm-hmm. I'm one of seven children. I'm number five of those seven. All boys, one girl, my baby sister. I'm the first in my family to graduate from high school and the first to graduate from college. To see my brother and sister come behind me and do the same thing, you can't tell me that I don't know what it means to see intergenerational poverty interrupted, largely at the hands of loving and caring adults and teaching professionals who spoke words of aspiration and inspiration into me and encouraged me to do things that I didn't think I could do, right? Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, our education system in this state has been under repeated assault at the hands of Republicans in the legislature and in the governor's mansion. And what we need to do is shore up our public education system and guarantee that every child, no matter what side of town you live on, has access to a high-quality education and the opportunity to learn. And I believe that that begins before kindergarten, that we've got to make sure our kids are getting access to high-quality early learning. Over 90% of your brain over the course of human life is developed in those early years. Almost 40% of our kids are starting kindergarten today in this state not ready to learn. Almost the same equivalent percent are not on grade level reading by the time they get to third grade. We've nearly pushed skills training that used to exist in high school, that if you weren't on a pathway to college, mm-hmm. that you could get a skill, shop, mechanical, electrical, technical training, right? Yeah. And unfortunately, they're far and in between now. And what we've got to do is have a little bit of return to that so that our kids who may not be on a path to college or may not even be interested in going to college can get a skill that they can monetize, get a good job, make a good wage, and take care of themselves and their family. I think we've got to return back to some of the basics and put the priorities of government, back into the lives of everyday people in this state. And unfortunately, these last 20 years, I think we've slid pretty far from that.
Well, let me ask you, recently Governor Scott signed a whole bunch of different things, but one of them was put in some public money towards private and charter schools. Yeah. What's your take on that?
So my issue is not with charter schools. I recognize that there are lots of different ways in which to learn and to teach. My problem is that we haven't fully funded our own public education system, where over 90% of our kids are still being educated. We ought to pay teachers what they're worth. They're working in horrendous conditions. They're working against all odds with a legislature that refers to them as failures, that refers to their schools as failure factories. What kind of environment is that to get the best and the brightest in the classrooms teaching our kids when you're insulting them every day of the weekend, stripping resources from them? You've got kids who are showing up, one, not ready for school, but two, with health problems that aren't being able to be tended to because we had a governor that said he wasn't going to extend Medicaid to the working poor in this state. You've got conditions that exist in our communities that, frankly, are continuously being ignored, and we're expecting kids to be able to show up at school ready to learn and teachers ready to teach when they're encountering all kinds of odds, and we've got to make that better for our students and for our teachers.
So what plan do you have, that's going to help us with things like that?
Well, I'll tell you. One, we're going to begin early. Between 0 and 5, we're going to have a system in this state that rates our early learning centers so that they're not just babysitting. They're preparing our kids with the fundamentals so that they can begin kindergarten ready to learn. We're also going to make sure that our kids are reading at grade level by the time they get to the third grade. We're going to get rid of these high-stakes tests that don't tell us what our kids know. It only tells them how well they can take a test, right?
Exactly, yes.
And unfortunately, it has pushed out so much of the learning. You've got social studies class teachers giving up their time to the math teachers because because the math is what's being tested on over our kids, right? And so we're producing citizens into the world who don't understand citizenship. And that's dangerous for democracy, right? And it's dangerous for our education system. And then what we're going to do is have a radical reinfusion of trades. I call it and refer to it on the campaign trail as Shop 2.0, that for our kids that may not be on a pathway to college, that we get them connected with a skill that allows them to get a good job and earn a good wage, right? And then what we're going to do for those kids who graduate and are on their way to college, if they choose to attend a state university, that they don't have to worry about graduating under a mountain of debt just to attend a state school.
Are we going to do that? Are we going to bring down the prices? Or
well, we're going to create in this state the opportunity for young people who are willing to give service back to this state to get access to higher education. You give us 2 years of service in a critical need area in this state, we'll pay for 2 years of your college. You give us 4 years of service to critical need areas, whether it be teaching or nursing, because we've got shortages in both, we'll educate you. But you got to give us some time back to helping building this state up.
And that makes a lot of sense, because that's what a lot of major companies do.
Absolutely.
I mean, you see companies like Microsoft and Google.
That's right.
What they do is they go and recruit people out of
best
high school.
Talent.
Exactly. And they say, hey, if you're gonna sign a contract to stay with us for X amount of time, then we'll go ahead and pay for your school.
So why wouldn't we do that for our best and brightest when it comes to our future? This is our state. These are our kids. We got to train them, educate them, and equip them for the world that they're entering into.
Now, what about areas like here we're in Broward County, but north of Broward County, north of Fort Lauderdale area, sugar is a big thing. And Big Sugar and, the plantations, that's actually a very big industry.
Sure,
what about things that we're going to do for those kind of industries and also things like the Everglades?
Yes.
These are very sensitive topics to a lot of my viewers.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, I mean, a lot of people draw the conclusion that you can't have agricultural purposes and keep the environment clean. I actually believe that you can do both. You just have to have a commitment to actually accomplishing both those things. We know that there are communities that their very livelihood depends on the agricultural purposes that they get up and go to work and tend to every single day, right? We've got to have a plan for those folks. We can't just talk about kicking them out of their jobs with no way to make sure that they can make a way for themselves and their families. I believe that our policy around how we keep the Everglades clean and reduce the level of nitrates and contamination going into that natural preserve needs to be guided by scientists and not politicians and not special interests.
Right.
That we need to be relying on what does the best science tell us about what our solution needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, special interests have been able to run roughshod over that process.
Right.
Somebody's political agenda or somebody's financial agenda. And who's being lost in that? The people.
Exactly.
The folks who stand in the gap, right, between those respective warring forces. And so we got to put the people at the center of our solutions, and we got to make sure that science recommends for us what the best strategy is for going forward, not the alternative.
No, one of the subjects that a lot of the people here are wondering about is, of course, the marijuana.
Yes.
Because right now we have the medical marijuana is passing in South Florida or in Florida.
Yes.
At last election.
Yeah.
Now we see states like California and recently Nevada, who's clearing up their debt with the marijuana money. What are we going to do about some of that here in Florida? Because we need some. I mean, tourism is big, but we still need some of the other kind of money as well.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, the citizens of this state overwhelmingly passed access for medical marijuana.
Right.
And the legislature has shirked its responsibilities when it comes to making sure that they fulfill the mandate that the voters chose for the direction of this state. And so I think priority one is to make sure that we fulfill that mandate first. If the voters of this state choose to move in the direction of recreational marijuana, then that's a choice that we have to implement at the government level to ensure that we fulfill the democratic direction of the voters. I believe in increased decriminalization of marijuana. I think far too many people are sitting in jails and in state prisons and in privatized prisons in this state frankly, due to over penalties, over prosecutions in some of these cases. And I think it's abhorrent that this state has basically turned its jail system over to the private sector, which doesn't necessarily have an interest in fixing and solving those problems. It has an interest in staying in business.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
So that leads me to my next question. What would we do about reversing some of these privatized jails? And what would we also do about some of the people that are sitting there right now, like you said? I mean, people that might have had one joint and got 5 years.
Absolutely. I think it's ridiculous. So first of all, I think mandatory minimums have been extremely detrimental to our criminal justice system. It has taken away prosecutorial discretion in many cases. It has taken away a judge's and a jury's ability to assess the facts and then be able to measure you on your situation and then render a penalty that is commensurate with that, right? So that's problem number one. Number two, I do not believe in the private prison system. I do not believe that folks who run private prison systems have the same interest as the government has in addressing and in solving what feels like an intractable problem around our criminal justice system. They should be run by the government, and we should commit ourselves to trying to empty them by basically making sure that people have the opportunity to turn their lives around, get on track, get a good job that they can earn a wage for themselves.
Right.
The best antidote that I've ever seen to solving crime is making sure people are working. Right? I mean, that's what we need to be focusing our attention on. Now, yes, there are hardened criminals that we have to deal with. You commit the crime, you got to do the time and the punishment associated with that. But once you have served and paid your debt to society, you should be able to re-enter society and be able to make a way for yourself. And unfortunately, it seems that you can make a mistake in this country and be punished forever for that one mistake.
No, and you just mentioned to reenter in society and make a living, make a way for yourself. Now, reentering society, what does that mean for like getting back your voters' rights and your rights to
absolutely
all these different rights
your
that are taken from
that have been taken? Absolutely, yeah. I believe in rights restoration in this state. 1.6 million Floridians right now don't have their ability to vote and to participate in the democratic process in this state. Overwhelmingly, those individuals are being penalized for nonviolent offenses, right? Many of them drug-related and otherwise. It's a travesty, and we are one of the few states that still have these, in my opinion, Jim Crow-type laws on the books. And I think it's unacceptable. It's been bad for our economy, and it's bad for our communities that these individuals return to without the opportunity to then enter into a workforce that lets them create worth and value for themselves and be productive and contributing members to society. So it's not only bad public policy, but it's also bad economic policy. Doesn't serve our state well.
All right. Well, I thank you very much for being on Roundtable with Steve. I know you have an event you have to get
Indeed,
to this evening
yeah.
right here in, at West Palm
That's
Beach.
Right.
And I wish you well on the campaign trail. And I just want to say anytime that you're in South Florida, definitely let me know. We would definitely love to get you back on the show again.
I love it. And all right. Thanks to your viewers. Please continue to follow Steve and his daughter, who's not on camera, and the work that they're doing to bring really relevant and valuable information to our communities. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you all and introduce myself.
Okay, thank you.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Take care.
All right. And next time I interview you, I hope to be calling you Mr. Governor.
I'll take it. I'll take that.